It's so dark in here. Oh, I know I left the light on in here. What? This is not even my living room. What is happening? Wait, am I having a dream? This feels like a stage. Oh, come on, this had better not be one of those theater nightmares. No, it feels more like a power dream. The kind where you can create anything you want. Let there be light! Darkness! Light!
Hey.
I've never had an audience in my dream before.
Or a microphone.
Is this on? Oh my God, we are in a dream and we're in it together. Oh, oh my God. Oh, let me take it in. Let's start all over. Hey, dream audience. Every time I give you one of these, give me a hey. Hey!
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 And every time I go like this, I want you to go, summertime. Are you ready?
Summertime.
Now, even though we're ultimately in my dream, you're all dreamers. And I want you to know how powerful you are. So, why don't we give you a chance to do that light trick? So when I go like this, I want you to chant, darkness, darkness, and see if you can get the lights to go out for a few seconds.
Darkness, darkness.
Commit,
darkness,
commit. Whoa! You did it. But lights, lights, lights. Just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I have no mic all of a sudden. One. See how powerful you are? I didn't say mic to make the mic go dark. So just for tonight, no more talk of darkness. Forget these wide-eyed fears. I'm here. Nothing can harm you. My words will warm and calm you. Let me be your freedom. Let daylight dry your tears. I'm here with you, beside you, to guard you and to guide you. All I ask is every waking moment, turn my head with talk of
summertime.
Summertime. All you say is true. That's all I ask of you. Let me be your shelter. Let me be your light. You're safe. No one will find you. Your fears are far behind you. All I want is freedom. A world with no more night, and you always beside me, to hold me and to hide me,
So say you'll share with me one love, one lifetime. Let me lead you from your solitude. Say you need me with you here beside you. Say you love me, for you know I do. Dream audience, that's all I ask of you.
I am on a stage. It has been so long, and a room full of friendly faces and no critics. Oh my God. So as we get started, I want you to know that I have a wish for you, each and every one of you. And that is that you let go. For tonight, for this dream, let go of your habitual head. Let go of the limitations. Open and let yourself have a new experience. Let yourself dream. And as I share my stories, think about what's important to you. Dare to dream. That is the first part of this wish for you. The second part of this wish. Hold on one second. I would love for Brian and to remove the keyboard, please. You see, when you're dreaming, you don't rehearse your dreams. You go with the flow of your dreams. So the second part of this dream, of this wish, is that you will let yourself play tonight. Let go, be like a child. And I am tripping over the keyboard things. I have some tools to help you out. So if you just look under your chairs, you have some surprises there waiting for you. Some play toys. Something to help you with your childlike. You got some confetti, and you got some noisemakers. So I also now want to give you a moment to put part of you into the energy of this dream. So I am going to start pointing and go around the room like this. And when I get near you, I want you to holler out the name of the favorite place that you have ever lived. It can be a city, a state, or a country. Are you ready? Holler it out. Wait a minute. Did I hear North Carolina? Yep. North Carolina, come up here. I'm going to keep pointing. Keep calling them out. I don't see any screaming going on here. What this is for me is a chance. Silence. Is a chance for you to put something that matters to you out there. Part of your energy. Speaking of North Carolina, that's where I'm from. Come up here. Come on up here. Give a hand for North Carolina, please. What's your name?
Phil Hall.
Phil Hall. Where are you from in North Carolina?
Durham.
I used to live 30 minutes down the road from Durham. That is so cool. Well, would you be willing to play?
Sure.
We said we're going to love and we're going to play.
Okay.
So you sit right there. I want as much North Carolina energy up here as I can. I was counting on this later in the dream, but I found a way. Put that hat on.
I went to this school.
You did? That was the school he went to. That is so cool. So when they cheer, I want you to cheer with the pennant. And since it's North Carolina, give us a Tar Heel. Okay. So let's cheer with him. You ready? That is so cool. Wait a minute. I think I have a better idea for you. Do you see where you're sitting, kind of close to that piano?
Yeah.
Have you ever imagined playing a musical instrument?
I've thought about it.
Would it touch you? Would it move you? Has it a part of your dream at some point in your life?
My daddy played.
I love that. This is a power dream, Phil. Scooch on over there. Scooch on over there.
Do I get a key?
Damn it! We're gonna speed it up. Power dreams, anything is possible. Now just imagine you have invested tons of energy into your dream, and now you can play the piano. Play the piano with rhythm.
They call you Lady Luck, but there is room for doubt. At times you have a very unladylike way of running out. You're in this dream with me. The pickings have been lush. And yet before the evening is over, you might give me the brush. You might forget your manners. You might refuse to stay. And so the best that I can do is pray. Love be a lady tonight. Love be a lady tonight. If you've ever been a lady to begin with, luck be your lady tonight. Luck, let a gentleman see how nice a dame you can be. I know the way you've treated other guys you've been with, but luck be a lady with me. A lady doesn't leave her escort. It isn't fair, it isn't right. Some other guy's dice. So let's keep the party polite. Never get out of my sight. Stick with me, baby. I'm the fella you came in with. Luck be a lady. Luck be a lady. Luck be a lady tonight.
Phil Hall, ladies and gentlemen. Dreamers. You did pretty great for your first time. Oh, my goodness. So, I began calling on life a long time ago to support my dreams. I knew from the time I was a little kid that I wanted my life to be great adventure. Oh, I wanted so many cool adventures. And around the age of 12, my adventure led me to stage for the first time, and I was hooked. I loved it. I just had no idea that my adventure would eventually take me to some pretty remarkable places. So I want to share some of those with you tonight. This is Lincoln Center, and I got to sing a ton of roles right there on that stage. Notice there are 5 balconies. Look and see how high one balcony is in this room. Imagine 4 more on top of it. It's so hard to get the scope of it. Even the curtain is 4 balconies high. So because we're in a power dream, I want you to have every experience that I've had with me. So I'm gonna bring you up on stage with me. That's what it looks like from the stage. And it's kind of intimidating, but if you think that's intimidating, wait till it looks like this. And so I want to take you to my first experience of being at Lincoln Center for a second. Imagine looking at that curtain. I am standing just behind that curtain on the far right side. And I am standing there trying to stay calm. It is just a few minutes before curtain. And I know that in just a couple of minutes, stagehands are gonna come from both sides and create a little hole in that curtain for me to move through as the first actor to appear and sing in this production of A Little Night Music. And so I have never done this before, and I'm standing there when all of a sudden, I feel a tap on my right shoulder. Guess who it is? Stephen Sondheim. Now, I don't know if all of you know the Broadway world, but Stephen Sondheim is probably the most famous composer lyricist in Broadway history. And there he's standing, and he goes, "Ron, I have been meaning to tell you, I want to change some words in this first song." Okay. Would you mind singing some new words? No. No, of course, yes. Tell me the new words. And he told me the new words, and I'm trying to remember them, feverishly going over them in my mind, and all of a sudden I became aware of 3,000 people got quiet on the other side of the curtain. So I knew the lights went down, and yes, here come the stagehands, and they split the curtain, and there we go, sorry. Previews. I was hit by a spotlight. The show was a huge success. I will never forget the wall of sound that hit the stage as cheers from 3,000 people at the end of the first act and at the end of the show. Oh my God, it became the hottest ticket in town. We were all over the moon. And it was a rousing ovation and a standing ovation and cheers. And after tongue congratulations and signing autographs. And that was the night that my dream changed. Because when I walked back to my apartment, I realized that I still felt like the little kid from North Carolina who was filled with insecurity and self-doubt. I had just reached a milestone, and now it seemed so far away. And that night, I became clear about some very distinct and important things. Like most people I've ever met, I grew up in a household with some distinct challenges. My two siblings and myself grew up in this household, but I tell my story, I leave it to them to tell their versions of what it was for them. My biggest challenge was that I grew up with a father who never said one single thing to me that I can remember. Not one conversation. He was right there. It was so confusing. My father was a giant to me. He was a semi-pro baseball player. And not once did he invite me out into the yard to teach me to throw or shoot a ball. It was so confusing. And so, in that moment of contrast between the glamour and the insecurity, I became aware that my dream had been driven by trying to figure out what I could do to make my father proud. How much did I have to achieve? What did I have to do? Who did I have to be? I was so focused on him and then other adults who became important to me. Who do I need to be? Tell me who I need to be in order to be what you need me to be. I was working so hard to give them an experience, to make them proud of me, that I was not in touch with myself. Whew. Huge revelation. And so I began to change my dream that night. So important to share that part of the journey with you. And so I began to think, okay, where do I start? What do I want? What is important to me? What touches me? What is true to me? What will give me the experiences that are meaningful to me? I spent so much of my early life alone. Oh, connection, heartfelt connection, authentic heart-to-heart connection. That's what I wanted. That's what was important. That's what I was going to commit myself to. And I have. Secondly, I worked so hard. I was so serious and focused that I decided I want to play. I want to enjoy. I want to have moments that matter from play, play, play. And so by the time this evening is over, I hope you will be clear as can be that I have become true to those two things. In order to start that, I'm gonna make a confession. I'm gonna bring you all the way to my present life. Then we'll go back and look at the journey and how I got there. Please be thinking about your journeys as I do. My confession is that about 2 years ago, I fell in love. Oh, I fell hard. And this is not something that I've talked too much about in public, so this feels like the right time. And so, you know what? Why don't I just show you a picture? This is even better. Dennis! I fell in love with Dennis! Right? Oh my God! I became obsessed with Dennis! And there's more confession. That was not the only new love. I fell in love with a community of people. oh my God, a community of people who have been so supportive and open-hearted and help each other. I quite honestly don't know when I go to the club if I love tennis more or if I love the people more. Because if you've been around me at the club, you know that I don't leave the club without at least two or three hugs. You know what? Rather than tell you about it, let me show you. When you all got your bags, two of you should have randomly found a ticket that invites you to come up on the stage. Look for them, see if you got it. Thank you. I hear somebody. Make your way up here. Yay, come on up. Come on up. If we can help her through here.
Okay.
Yay. You can't get there except all the way over here. Let's give her a hand. It's exposing to be pulled up on stage. Have a seat. So, what's your name?
Gail.
Gail, who's surprised by a microphone. That's a pretty name. That's a pretty name. What's your name?
Gail.
What? You guys are famous. Are you gales of wind? Or are you gales of laughter? Or are you gales of song?
Wait a minute. That's G-A-L-E.
This is a power dream. You're gonna worry about spelling?
All right.
What is important here? Are you ready to play?
Yes.
Are you ready to love?
Yes.
Hear it for the Gales. They are Gales of laughter and song. Mwah. Mwah. Good sports in many different ways. Now I wish. No problem. I love the enthusiasm, but we'll be here till 10. So I wish that I could say that I jumped from my revelations all the way to love and play. And it's so great. You see This is the kind of people that I'm talking about at the club. However, there was a journey. There was a journey that got me there. So thank you for going through one more tender segment here, because it's so important to the journey of creating a second version of the dream. Having a father that I've already told you about created a lot of experiences that I knew I needed to go back and re-nurture. I'm going to give you an example of one. I told you there was never a time where we went out and played catch, but when I got to 8, somehow my father decided it was time to take me to the city basketball tryouts. I didn't even know where we were going. I had no idea until we pulled up and we found ourselves in this gym. I had never even held a basketball in my hands. I do not have to tell you that it was the most humiliating, embarrassing, confusing thing that I had ever been through. And I was one of the last 2 people picked for a team before we drove home in silence. And I thought, surely this week my father's going to teach me or get me a basketball. I ended up not only going back week after week with no guidance from a coach or a dad, I ended up on the city championship team. That is not a good thing when you are clueless. I'm going to wait until the ice gets poured. Sorry, it's too tender a moment. I can't even begin to tell you, week after week, going through humiliating drills at the beginning where I was just as clueless the second time I touched the ball as I was the first, and then I would go sit on the bench, panicked that they were going to call me into the game. Guess when they called me into the game? The championship game, the final game, because the coach had to give everybody a chance to play. I ran up and down that court like a deer in headlights, petrified what I would do if someone threw me the ball. So you get the point that I had some nurturing of old places before I could move into freedom to play and feel so confident to love and open my heart. And so I want to share a little bit of that journey with you, because I thought, what do I need to do? And I said, you know, let me figure out what I wished my mom and dad had known how to do. And let me show up and begin to treat myself that way. And so I decided to offer some loving messages to my little boy. That's me at 3. And so let me share one of the messages that I knew I needed to share with him.
Kid, you're my son. What I've done to you is rotten. I made my choice. You can see a different song. Marching in time to a tune I've forgotten. I loved you. I love you. I meant no disgrace. This here is love. When we're talking face to face, his son. I, for one, would take love slower. Honor yourself, you can see a different song. Watch as you grow, how your voice gets much lower. You'll be kid, a man kid. Whatever the song, sing for yourself as we march along. A man kid, you'll be a kid. Whatever the song, love from your truth as we march along. I love you.
Thank you. So, as I began to think about being a man, what kind of man did I want to be? And I began to realize that even though all of us went through a lot of stuff as children, as adults, we get to decide, who am I going to be? What kind of man or woman am I going to be in the world? And one of the most effective ways that I found to do that was to focus on some simple qualities. And the first two that I decided were definitely a part of the man that I want to be: willingness and courage. Willingness and courage. It takes a ton of willingness and courage just to show up for our lives every day, to show up to our connections with each other, to show up and face the challenges and the growing pains and the learning curves. It takes courage to show up when there are conflicts, to talk about it and work out the misunderstandings. Willingness and courage. And then sometimes life gives us bigger moments to practice these qualities. And for this story, I take you to the Kennedy Center in Washington, D.C. I remember it. I was there. So let's take you inside and put you on stage. There we have the Kennedy Center. And this is how it feels to look out at all the people. So I was hired to do the baritone lead in the second act of this opera. And about 10 minutes before curtain, I had gotten into my makeup as the Harlequin, waiting for the second act, and the head of the company came in and he goes, "Ron, we have a problem." Theme. "We have a problem. The baritone lead from the first act is stuck in an ice storm and cannot get here. You are our only chance. Would you be willing to go on stage in a costume you've never been in, holding a musical score, and reading this Strauss music by sight in German?" "Das stimmt." Thank you, she relates. Willingness and courage. Holy shite. I realized in that moment, I'd never heard of anything like this. This was clearly a destiny moment of choice. What would I do? It was either do it, or they were going to refund over $100,000 of tickets. So I was like, okay, let's try. Let's do it. Let's see. It was literally the scariest thing I have ever experienced and hope to ever experience in my life. But I showed up. I showed up. And the coolest part of the story is not even that. The audience was quite generous because they knew what was happening. What was the coolest part of this story is what happened two nights later. I got a chance to inspire one of my heroes, who is the epitome of willingness and courage. So this picture is from People magazine. CNN was also there that night, filming. So I'm the harlequin in the orange hat. The woman standing right in front of me is Ruth Bader Ginsburg, Supreme Court Justice. And to the right is Justice Scalia. Right after they took this photo, the head of the company called me in front of the group and recounted what I had done. And so I got a chance to inspire one of my heroes for a moment with my willingness and courage. I will never forget that. So I can't bring you to that performance that I did, but I told you I want you to have new experiences tonight. And chances are, most of you have never been to an opera, and I'm not about to stand up here and sing you an opera, but guess where I'm gonna take you? To another production that I did, where I'm on stage with about 100 cast members. Gorgeous, right? My character is standing just to the right of the princess in the center. This is a Puccini opera called Turandot. And since most of you have never had this experience, what I want you to feel is what it is like to be on stage with all those people, 60 members of the orchestra in the pit, singing to a room of 3,000 people with no microphones. But I want you to hear and feel what that's like. So I'm gonna play about 15 seconds of an opera, and the only voice you're gonna hear is me. So now you've been to the Cliff Notes. That's what it feels like to be up there surrounded by all that gorgeous music. There's really nothing like it, I'll tell you. So willingness and courage, I guarantee you, even though there were no heightened stakes, just to stand on that stage and do that night after night helped me build tons of willingness and courage. So be thinking about what qualities might be important to you as we keep going through this. And now for the third and final quality that I'll talk about tonight, I'll identify it at the end of the story. We're gonna go all the way across the ocean. That jewel of a theater is called the Bolshoi Theater in Moscow. That is one of the most famous theaters on the planet. It is so beautiful. So let's take you inside. It's grand. And now let's take you up on the stage. That's what it looks like and feels like. I'm telling you, the front of every one of those balconies is literally covered in gold. It's not painted, it is gold. It is profound. The box, the giant box in the back, was built for the Tsar. So much history. I was hired to do the first American opera in history at the Bolshoi. And so for the story that I'm gonna share, we're not gonna stay in the opera house. We're gonna go across town to the hotel. Not that kind of a story. Let me grab a chair. For this story, we were staying in Hotel Ukraina. This was the only hotel that all foreigners had to stay in at the time. No Russians were allowed in the hotel except in the front lobby. We were guarded by young Russian soldiers with machine guns. I would come and go from the hotel on my adventures that I continued to have. I'm not gonna tell the stories, but I got involved with friends from the gym who ended up being in the underground, and we were followed around by the KGB. It was amazing, such an adventure. So for this story, I was coming back from the gym and the soldiers were getting used to seeing me. And so one of them came up and in very little English, basically asked me if I would be willing to do an arm wrestling match with one of their friends. I thought, wow, that probably took a lot of courage for him to ask. And so, yeah, of course I will do that. Why don't we do it tonight after dinner? Cool. So I go down to dinner in the basement of the hotel. That's where we ate all our meals because we had no capacity to communicate. This was before people were used to Americans. And so I finished dinner and I came back upstairs to see if they were ready to do the thing. And the lobby was packed with people. And I thought, I wonder what is going on. No. I felt like I was in a Rocky movie. I'm not kidding. And the guy came and grabbed me and he took me and he sat me in my chair and the crowd parted. I kid you not, the crowd parted. And this strapping soldier came forward, totally stern, sat down in front of me, stared a hole through me. And because I was a gymnast, my hands and forearms are stronger than most other sports would create. And so I was confident, he was confident, and we started. And we pushed and we pushed and we pushed. Nothing was happening. All of a sudden, he took a deep breath and literally roared. And my arm didn't budge. And he had the life go out of his eyes. I could see it right in front of me. And so my hand started to move, and thank God, some wiser part of me started hammering my head. What are you doing? This means nothing to you. This means everything to this guy. He is surrounded by his friends and his family. What are you doing? And so I stopped pushing. He's the only one in the room who knew it. He stopped pushing. And he's looking at me in disbelief. And we're just gonna stay here forever. And I guess because my hand moved here, it made the guy in charge nervous. So he came running over and he said, I'm assuming in Russian, it's a tie. So I stood up and went to my room and thought the story was over. No. The next day, I was ready to go to rehearsal. And as I was leaving the hotel, there's that young soldier. I don't know how long he'd been waiting there. And so as he saw me, he came running up to me, the hugest smile on his face. It was very meaningful to me. Sorry, when I share meaningful things to people who matter, it's hard to contain it sometimes. So he took my hand, looked me right in the eye with the most beautiful smile, and we didn't even have common language, but... And when he took his hand away, he had given me a Russian sportsman medal. What do you think the quality of compassion gave me that day? Obviously, I still have this. It means the world to me. It represents so much that we can practice in our daily lives with each other. Ah, so the subject on the table was competition. I dealt with competition constantly in that career. I was hired to do over 60 leading roles all over the world. And there were at least as many auditions that I did not get hired for, that I was not right for, that I was rejected. I had to deal with both sides of competition, and I thought I had gotten pretty good at it. Until my new love came along. I sucked. I was used to being a leading role person in very glamorous scenarios, and I now became a baby giraffe. So, in order to tell you how I worked through this one, I have a friend who was pivotal in helping me work through this one. And so I'm going to invite Melissa Gibson to come to the stage. Thank you.
I only hope it's confetti worthy.
She needs tons of confetti after this because it takes tons of courage and willingness to come up here. But the story is so cool. So, competition. The song we're going to do is called Anything You Can Do, I Can Do Better. But that song did not capture the story for me. And Melissa noticed it, and she sent me the kindest note, got my attention, and then she became my cohort working through this. So the words of the song don't work for us, so we got together and wrote some new words, and hopefully, since they're new words, we'll both remember them, but if we don't, we'll have a really good time. Anything I can do better. I can hit every shot better than this.
Not the point.
What'd you say?
Not the point.
What'd you mean?
Not the point, not the point, not the point. You could be much kinder, or you'll be behinder.
I will try to find her, now it's back to the grinder. Jesse told me much the same.
So are you insane?
Oh, what can I say? Every time that I play, I will work on it. I will work on this as long as it takes.
I'll be there.
You're the best.
You're my bud.
Here's a hug.
Not with sweat.
You're the best. You're the best. So I worked on it. I worked on it. Oh, I worked on it. I even had to tear my meniscus and be off the courts for 4 months to humble me out. So I got grateful. So I got better, and the story turned into this. Every time that I play, I now hit kinder. I needed help to get over this.
Now you're set.
Yes, you bet.
Now you're set.
Even when.
Now we're set.
Play a set. Play a set. So, we conquered that. Ha. We got better at that. And then, we moved on to the next challenge. Doubles. Are you ready?
Yes.
Anything they can do, we can do better. We can do everything better than them.
But don't tell.
No, I won't. You don't tell.
No, I won't.
You're the best.
You're the best.
You're the best. Give her some confetti. Come on, confetti. Encore. Melissa is not remotely. Help her with that challenge. Could be a bar challenge. So, Melissa is not remotely the only one who has helped me with challenges in this room. Tons of you in this room have helped me at various points. I cannot tell you how grateful I am. And in that spot of gratitude, I want to take a moment to say, this man right here, Phil Hall, is one of the most compassionate people I've ever known in my life. We have known each other a long time. He's such a good sport on top of, so it's the perfect let's play. I can't begin to tell you how much you mean. Thank you. Thank you for being here. He is one of the most sought after Broadway pianists in New York. So he drove up today and he's driving back right after. In that same space of gratitude, I have another cool story. Do you remember? Well, let me tell it this way. When I started playing tennis, I went into a drills class and met a bunch of nice people. When I came back to the drills class, one of the people was still there, was there again, and he looked at me and said, "I knew it." I was like, "What?" He said, "I went home and I looked through my playbills. I was the lighting designer of your first show at Lincoln Center. And he was the lighting designer of my final performances at Lincoln Center. Gary Martyr. He is a member of the tennis club. While we're on a theme of compassionate people. Couldn't be more, isn't that like the coolest story? Wow. So, my wish is that I have had a chance to touch each one of you in the room in some way. And if I haven't yet, watch out, because I'm coming. There have been so many I'm grabbing my chair again. So many opportunities at the tennis club to do various things. I know I had a drink back. Oh, I put it over there. Sorry. unrehearsed dream. You'll be grateful that I take these sips. Vodka. So I decided I wanted to do a song that would express my gratitude and my desire to be there to touch your lives as well. So when people ask me about my career, they tend to be most interested in two particular shows. And the first of those is Les Mis. Yes. So willingness and courage and compassion didn't just get worked on and left behind. The deal with Les Mis, you see this barricade, it's huge. It comes together as two huge pieces of set that meet in the middle, and the French Revolution takes place. Now, if you strip away all of the smoke and the lights and you just put the set there, I went in to do the baritone lead in Les Mis, and I got one rehearsal. For this rehearsal, I was the only person in costume. The cast, who was already doing 8 shows a week, did an extra run through for me to be able to go in the show, so they were not in makeup and dress. And so there were no lights, there was no orchestra, it was just the bare bones and me getting used to costume changes and such. The entire production team of Les Mis was out in the audience. And they said, cool, see you in the morning. I was like, okay. So I show up the next morning. They gave me detailed notes of adjustments, things they wanted different, things I needed to work on, for a solid hour. And then they said, and we were so pleased with what you did, we want you to go on tonight for your debut. I definitely had a theme in my career. And so I did, and I had one of the most meaningful runs of a show ever. Such meaningful music. And so the willingness and courage part was there, but now, actually, let me tell you a couple of lighter anecdotes. You think when you get to a Broadway show, everything's worked out. It's professional. There are no mistakes happening in Broadway shows. We literally had one show where the two huge pieces of this barricade with the most dramatic music, boom, boom, supposed to come in to give us something to fight the French Revolution. And it went, we restaged the French Revolution live, and the music kept going. It was the wackiest memory. And then, I don't know if you know about the set of Les Mis, but the entire stage is a giant revolve. And so you do one scene, and then you don't even have to exit. The revolve goes, and you end up going into the shadows in the back, and a new scene comes in. Well, that's really, really cool until the revolve doesn't stop and you start walking backward and you arrest Fantine walking backward the entire scene. Oh my God. Welcome to Broadway. So for the compassion story, there's a little kid in the show, plays a character called Gavroche. And he plays a pivotal role when this barricade scene happens. And these students who are fighting literally are running out of ammunition. And Gavroche hears this and he goes catapulting across the enemy lines to gather ammunition from the dead French soldiers on the other side. And he is tragically shot, and it kills the audience, of course. Oh my God. This little kid, Brian, became, I don't even know, like a son. It was so cool, the camaraderie that we had. One day, we're sitting there, and he goes, can I tell you a secret? And I go, yes. He goes, I want to be Javert when I grow up. It was so cool. And so I said, you know what? Tonight, you don't perform. The other Gavroche performs. So you just come to my dressing room. And when I do my makeup for Javert, I'm going to do the makeup on your face too. So you can see what it's going to look like when you grow up. Now, Javert ages a bunch during Les Mis, and so I went ahead and did the most extreme makeup, but such a sweet moment. So here's a picture of me as Javert with little Gavroche. Isn't that cool? So those are my Les Mis stories. And the other show that people want to know about is the experience of what it's like to be Phantom. And so when I did Phantom, my version of Phantom, I got to do it with Kristen Chenoweth. And it was truly a joy, truly a joy. But the story I'm going to tell, let me go ahead and pull this out. The story I'm going to tell is not from being in the show. It happened after. So let me make sure I'm not messing anything up. Cool. So this story happened when I was doing a show at Lincoln Center after I was done with Phantom, and a friend came up and he goes, "Ron, I have a really good friend who is a rock star, and he's about to write a rock opera, and he wanted me to ask a couple of opera singers who have that legitimate sound, who are emotional communicators. And I was wondering if you would be willing to do it." And he chose me and an opera singer that you've probably seen on television and a lot of different things, named Dame Kiri Takanawa. So most people don't know opera, but you've seen her like on Downton Abbey and various things. So bottom line, I show up. I don't even know who I'm singing for, but I decided to sing this beautiful song from Phantom of the Opera. And I walk in, and who should be there? Jerry Garcia from The Grateful Dead. And I sang this song, and he literally cried the whole time. Such a teddy bear of a person, so, so moving. So I am going to attempt to resurrect this song for you tonight.
Nighttime sharpens, heightens each sensation. Darkness stirs and wakes imagination. Silently the senses abandon their defenses. Unwind in this darkness, which you know you cannot.
fight the darkness of the music of the night. Close your eyes and surrender to your darkest dream.
Thank you so much. Before we close with one more song and then something I want to do with all of you, I just want to thank Neil Howard, the owner of Colony. The staff here. It's really easy to get up on a microphone and go, everyone was wonderful. It's the best. I'm telling you, the staff here has blown me away. Couldn't be more helpful, supportive, rare. Kind of the way I feel about the tennis community in this area. So rare. So I also want to thank a lot of you for driving in hours to get here, to be here for this night. It means the world to me. And this final song is a message to all of us, something that we need to remember. That little child I sang to earlier, that's who we all are on the inside. That innocence is right in there. And we need to treat each other with courage and willingness and compassion, which I see happening so often. This is a fundraiser for the tennis club. And so I see it happening with my peeps for sure, and with the tennis club. It's so beautiful. I was not kidding when I said I'm not sure whether it's the game or the people that keeps me wanting to come back so often. Please. And so, this final song is a message for us to remember how we can treat each other.
Careful the things you say, children will listen. Careful the things you do, children will see. And learn. Children may not obey, but children will listen. Children will look to you for which way to turn, to learn what to be. Careful before you say, listen to me. Children will listen. Careful the wish you make, wishes are children. Careful the path they take, wishes come true. Not free. The spell can last past what you can see and turn against you. Careful the tale you tell, that is the spell. Children will
Since all of you didn't have a chance to come up on stage and volunteer to sing like Melissa, I want to give you a chance to sing before we go home. So we are going to do a ditty that I hope you all know called Row, Row, Row Your Boat. And we're going to divide the room into three parts. Part one, part two, and part three. I'll be part number four. Let's sing the song through one time together. You ready? So hold on, guys. So here we go. It's gonna be row, 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 row your boat gently down the stream. Merrily, 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 life is but a dream. Pause. Group one, I'm gonna point at you as you come in and sing through the entire song twice. Twice. You ready?
Row, row, row your boat. 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 Gently down the stream. Merrily, 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 life is but a dream. Row, row, row your boat. Gently down the stream. Merrily, 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 merrily. Some people can't count after two drinks. Merrily, just me. My dream. Merrily, 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 life is but a dream. Thank you.
Yeah.